Good evening, friends. I welcome you all to this evening session of live teleconferencing on the topic of dermatology. To my left is Dr. Vibhu Mehndi Ratta, who is Professor of Dermatology, Lady Harding Medical College. She would be talking to us on the basic sciences of dermatology. To my right is Dr. R.C. Sharma, former Director Professor, Department of Dermatology, Lady Harding Medical College. To his right is Dr. Sood, who is the Executive Director, National Board of Examination. May I now request Dr. Mehndi Ratta to start with her lecture.
A very good evening to all the students who are watching us on this session on basic dermatology as applied, basic sciences as applied to the dermatology. So I shall be talking on the structure of the hair follicle and its function, and what is the importance of the structure as well as the normal function in the diseases of the hair. So we know that hair do not serve any vital function in the body, but still their importance is undeniable to all the human beings, as they are the defining feature of mammals. They also serve the function of being a sensitive touch receptor. They also afford protection to us, because we all know that if we have a thick head of hair on the scalp, then the scalp remains protected by the UV rays. Definitely, it also serves a great amount of cosmetic function, because losing hair on the scalp can be very distressing to every individual, whether a child or a young person or an old person. So hair does have a vital importance for the psychological functioning. Now, coming to the various types of the skin. As we know that some parts of our skin, they show evidently hair, and some parts do not show hair on the skin. So broadly, we can have two kinds of skin on the body, that is the glabrous skin, which is the non-hairy skin. And we all know that if we see our palms and soles, there are no hair follicles. And the hair-bearing skin is present on the scalp, it is there in the axillae, it is there on the beard, it is there in the upper lip area. What are the various parts of the hair? So broadly, we must understand that hair has two structures, that is the hair follicle, and the hair follicle is the part of the hair that lies in the skin, and that is the part we cannot see, but that is the active part which produces the end result or the hair shaft that is visible to us and lies above the skin. Now, this hair shaft, as we all know, is a very hard structure. It bears the insults of all kinds of physical agents and chemical agents and lasts all throughout the life. So it has to be made up of a very thick structure, and that is the keratin. Keratin is a type of dead protein. Now, what determines the shape of the hair? We know that some individuals would have curly hair, some would have straight hair. So what determines this? Basically, this depends on the cross section of the hair. In case the cross section is circular, it is going to give a straight shape to the hair, and if it is elliptical, then it is associated with curly haired individuals. Now, the hair growth is around 0.3 millimeter per day.
Ma'am, I would like to ask you, ma'am, why is it important to know the hair structure?
Yes. The hair structure is very important because there are different parts of the hair that play a vital role in the functioning of the hair, the growth of the hair, and its normal function. Because as I said, that it is a sensory receptor, and there is a proper color to the hair, there is a texture of the hair. So all these, the appearance of the hair, the length of the hair, so all that is determined by the normal functioning of the hair is dependent on the normal structure. So without knowing the normal layers of the hair and what goes wrong where in the structure of the hair, we would not be able to understand the diseases of the hair. So that is why it is very important to know the structure of the hair, because there are some parts of the hair which are very vital to the hair growth, like the dermal papilla. So the injury to the dermal papilla or injury to the isthmus or the hair bulb, which are the vital parts of the hair, will completely destroy the hair. So it is very important for us to know where exactly they are localized and what is their normal structure. To identify the various diseases on histopathology also later on, when we do the sectioning, we look for the anatomy of the hair, the histopathology of the hair. Mm-hmm. So that correlates with different diseases. So to understand the different diseases also, it is important to know the basic structure. So can I have the slideshow, please? So this figure very clearly shows you the hair, and as you can see that the part of the hair which is above the skin and which is visible is known as the hair shaft. The part which is embedded in the skin is the hair follicle.
Can you show with the pointer?
Yes.
This part.
So as we can appreciate that this is the part of the hair which is lying obliquely on the skin surface. This is the part which is visible to all of us, is the hair shaft. This is the end result of this part which is in the skin, and this is known as the hair follicle. So this hair follicle has got different further parts which synthesize this keratinized product that is known as the hair shaft. And then I also want to just point out this structure, which is a lobulated structure, and it is lying in close approximation to the hair follicle in the upper dermis, and it is opening into the pilar canal. This is the sebaceous gland. So these two, they together form the pilosebaceous unit, and oil, the sebum that is there on the skin, is produced by the sebaceous glands, and it is released into the pilar canal. It goes up and then it contributes to the surface lipids on the epidermis. Another structure that you see here is the smooth muscle which lies in the dermis, and this is the erector pili muscle. Now the function of this muscle is basically that, as I said, that it is the hair acts as a sensory organ also. So in conditions or in circumstances where there is anxiety, fear, we have all experienced goose pimples. So this erector pili muscle, it makes the hair erect. Okay, so it straightens out the hair on the skin, which is appreciated as goose pimples. Now we must also understand that there are different types of hair depending upon the age. So there are a particular kind of hair that we see in the intrauterine life. In preterm babies who are born before term, they would often show a very thin downy growth of hair. These are very light colored hair. They are unmedulated, unpigmented, and normally these hair, they are shed inside the in utero only. Around 8 to 9 months of gestation, these hair are shed, and these hair are known as the Ladungo hair. But in certain conditions, like there is a problem which is known as congenital hypertrichosis lanuginosa, the baby is born with thick coat of Ladungo hair covering the body. After birth, we see two kinds of hair. And one is the villous hair, the other is the terminal hair. Now, to differentiate between the two, the villous hair, they are again just like Ladungo hair, they are very soft, unmedulated, and mostly unpigmented hair or very light colored hair, and they are not longer than 2 centimeters. They are present generally on the face. Whereas terminal hair, they are present on the scalp, and they also develop from these vellus hair at the time of puberty under the effect of various hormones like the androgens. So these terminal hair, they develop from vellus hair in the axillae and over the upper lip and form the mustaches and beard in men. So coming to the development and distribution of the hair follicles, so if we go back to the embryogenesis, we see that the first appearance of the hair is at around 9 weeks, and the side two pair is the eyebrows. And we should also remember that the total number of human the total number of follicles on the human scalp is around 10^5. So this is a fixed number. And let me tell you that whatever this hair follicle number that one is born with, this remains constant throughout life. There are no more additions, but as a result of exposure to the environmental or physical agents or injury to the hair shaft or some diseases of the hair, these hair follicles may reduce in number. And as the baby grows up and as aging takes place, the hair density, it decreases, because the body surface, the body increases in size, so the hair density decreases. In addition, we should also remember that there are certain racial variations in the hair density. Now this is important because sometimes, you know, patients would come to you saying that they have excessive hair growth on the body. So how to determine whether this is excessive or this is normal? So we must remember the race, that they whether it is a racial variation, because some of the races would have a higher density. Say for example, Africans, they have a greater, you know, hair density than the Americans, and Americans would have a greater hair density than the Mongolians.
Ma'am, you have told us about the density of hair. And what about the length of hair?
Yes.
Some people have longer hair and some do not.
Yes. So in my slides that I'll be showing you subsequently, hair has a, you know, growth cycle. It has cyclic activity, and this cyclic activity of the hair has got different phases, and which we categorize as the growth phase, that is known as the anagen phase. And the length of the anagen, that determines the length of the hair. So all those people who are lucky to be born with long hair, it means that they have a long anagen. Normally on an average it varies from 2 to 5 years, and average you can take as 3 years, but due to some pathological, you know, factors playing a role, sometimes this anagen is cut short. From even a normal average of 3 years, it may be shortened to say 2 years, 1 year. So then the hair, they fail to grow. So that is the problem. Now coming to the parts of the hair follicle. So just to recapitulate, that we remember that hair is a keratinized product of the hair follicle, and it can be divided into three parts. That is the infundibulum, the isthmus, and the bulb. Now infundibulum, I'll be showing you the parts of the hair, is the part which is between the skin surface to the opening of the sebaceous duct. Then we have the isthmus, and this is the part that lies between the opening of sebaceous duct to the insertion of the erector pili muscle. And below this lies the suprabulbar portion. And the isthmus is an important part of the hair follicle, because we must remember that the stem cells, which have a potential to regenerate the hair, they lie in the lower part of the isthmus, close to the insertion of the muscle. So this figure would help you understand the different parts of the hair. So here we can see that there are two structures which are attached to the hair follicle. On the top you see the sebaceous gland, and below this is this muscle, the erector pili. Now the hair is divided into three portions. If we see from the top, the part of the hair that is from the surface of the epidermis up to the opening of the sebaceous duct is known as the infundibulum. Part of the hair which is between the opening of the sebaceous duct to the insertion of the erector pili muscle is the isthmus, and the part which is below this is the suprabulbar, and the hair bulb, which contains the dermal papilla, and the dermal matrix, and entire hair follicle is covered with different coverings. These are the inner root sheath, which is present only till the sebaceous gland. The outer root sheath, it covers the hair entirely up to the dermis, and then this outer root sheath has the outermost covering of the dermal connective tissue. Now coming to the hair shaft. So the hair shaft also has three layers, and these layers we should remember them as from outwards, inwards, cuticle, cortex and medulla, which is the innermost part of the hair shaft. Now the cells in the hair bulb, they form the inner root sheath, and the inner root sheath is the structure which disintegrates when the new hair emerges from the hair follicle. So this figure will help you understand the anatomy of the hair bulb in a better manner. So if we see the different layers of the hair moving from inwards to outwards, the innermost layer is the medulla of the hair, and as you can see that medulla is a very small portion of the hair, and medulla is variable. It may be there in some hair, it may not be there in all the hair, so it is a very variable structure. Outside the medulla we have the cortex. So cortex is a thicker layer of the hair follicle, and covering the cortex is the cuticle. I shall be telling you about the structure of the cuticle and its importance also. And outside cuticle, hair cuticle, we have the different layers of the inner root sheath. Now the inner root sheath has got innermost layer as the cuticle of the inner root sheath, then the Huxley's layer, and then the Henle's layer. So these three layers, they have their own function, as they contain undifferentiated cells in the region of the hair bulb, and they undergo keratinization, and finally they produce keratins, keratin filaments, and they lend the hardness to the hair. So it is very important that the keratinization of the inner root sheath takes place, because under certain genetic conditions or disorders of keratinization, this may not be proper. So there are hair shaft dysplasias and the hair may not be normal looking. Outside the inner root sheath we have the outer root sheath. This orange layer that you see is the outer root sheath. This covers the inner root sheath, and covering this outer root sheath we have this connective tissue layer. And then if we just come down to the region of the hair bulb, we can see that there is this indentation, and this structure is the, this is the cavity of the dermal papilla. Now this dermal papilla is a very important part of the hair bulb, as it is present only in the hair which is active and alive and which is dividing. Otherwise in a resting hair you would not see this indentation and this flask shaped structure. So in the hair bulb also we have some melanocytes and some dividing cells. So this is the active zone, the synthesizing zone of the hair follicle. Now coming to, just to recapitulate the structures that we saw. So hair bulb is basically the cells that surround the dermal papilla in the lower part of the hair follicle is called the hair bulb, and these cells, they have a potential to divide very fast, they have a high mitotic rate, they synthesize practically all the sheaths, the entire hair shaft is derived from here, the hair shaft and the inner root sheath, they are synthesized by the hair bulb. Coming to the dermal papilla. So if we remember from the picture that we saw, the dermal papilla is basically seen in anagen follicles, which are the follicles that are showing an active growth phase. and this is a flask shaped structure at the base of the hair. Now this dermal papilla, what does it contain? So it contains all the structures that are there in this dermis, that is it contains some fibroblast like cells, matrix and some of the dermal capillaries. So this is the only part of the hair which has got vascular supply. Rest of the hair is just keratin. Now very important to remember that the size of the hair follicle also depends on the volume of the dermal papilla. So thick hair would be determined by the size of the dermal papilla. Larger the size of dermal papilla, the hair follicles and the hair shaft would be thicker. This is also important from the point of view of the action of various hormones, as it forms the primary target organ for the action of the androgens. Androgens, they bring about a number of changes in the hair follicle. They shorten the anagen phase, and that is the reason why we see this male pattern baldness, which is very commonly seen in males. Now once again to recapitulate the structure of the hair bulb, if we move from the center of the hair bulb, so this shows the hair medulla, which is very thin. This is the hair medulla, and then outside the hair medulla lies the cortex of the hair. This is the hair cortex, and in the region of the bulb there would be dividing cells here. These cells, these keratinocytes, would divide to form keratins, keratin filaments, and would ultimately bring about the keratinization in the cortex. And outside the cortex is the cuticle, covered by again the inner root sheath, the three layers, the cuticle, the Huxley's layer and the Henle's layer, which is outermost covering is the outer root sheath. So this is the dermal papilla again, which is a flask shaped structure. And finally this is the dermal sheath, the outermost covering, that is the collagenous layer of the connective tissue in the lower part. This can also constitute the dermal papilla or new hair follicle in case it has been injured. So this is again the inner root sheath, and coming to the keratinization of inner root sheath, which is very important. And we should remember that the inner root sheath, it keratinizes by the formation of keratohyaline granules, and inner root sheath is composed of soft keratin, and the outer root sheath is it keratinizes with the help of trichilemmal keratinization and is composed of hard keratin, and it also has melanocytes which serve as reservoir melanocytes. Now coming to the cuticle, so what is the importance of cuticle? This is the covering that covers the cortex of the hair. Cuticle is composed of tile-like flattened cells which are overlapping and interlocking with the cuticle and surrounding the inner root sheath. There are about 5 to 10 overlapping cell layers which are composed of compact keratin, and they contain ultra high sulfur proteins. That is the reason that cuticle is very thick, and the outermost surface of cuticle has a coating of fatty acids. The function of the cuticle is that it serves as a barrier to the physical and chemical insult, and it also maintains the integrity of the hair shaft. In case the cuticle is damaged, it exposes the cortex, and that can lead to fracture of the hair shaft. So this shows the overlapping layers of the cuticular cells which are also interlocking with each other. Now back to cortex. So cortex is again a keratinized structure in a well formed hair follicle, and is composed of hard keratinous filaments which lie in the keratin proteins. And the keratin proteins in the cortex, they have three types of proteins. They can be high sulfur, they can be very high sulfur containing proteins, and they can also have high content of glycine and tyrosinase. Now, in case these proteins are deficient in sulfur, so then there are certain disorders of the hair that can arise. Say, for example, there is a condition called trichothiodystrophy, in which these sulfur containing amino acids, they are lacking in the hair, and the hair, they become brittle and they are very short and they fall very easily. Medulla, as I said, is variable. It may be there, it may not be there, it may be a continuous layer or it may be discontinuous. And coming to the innervation, so this is also very important, that hair in the region of the isthmus has free nerve endings, and there are also Merkel cells in the region of this hair bulb, and these together, they make the hair work as a sensory receptor also. And the secretion of the Merkel cells, it has been proposed that they are involved in the hair cycle. So coming to the hair growth, so as I said early, that hair cycle is basically is repetitive sequence of growth of the hair, which is divided into anagen hair, catagen, telogen and exogen. Now the anagen phase is the period of active growth, and on an average in the normal human scalp there should be about 80 to 90% follicles in the anagen. Catagen phase in the hair cycle is the resting phase when the hair do not grow. There is no cell division, and if you see the hair structure, there would not be any dermal papilla. In the telogen phase is the period between completion of follicular regression and the next anagen phase, and the exogen is the shedding of the club hair and coming up of the new hair follicle. So this is just to show you a plucked anagen hair. So you can pluck the hair from the scalp. The anagen hair, first of all, are not easily pluckable, and then if you see them under the microscope, you will see that it is pigmented, first of all, very nicely pigmented, and then I'm afraid the lower part, the hair bulb is not very clear, so generally it shows the bulbous end and is covered with the outer root sheath and the connective tissue sheath also. Now this is the picture of a hair in the catagen phase. It shows an atrophic connective tissue sheath without the well developed hair bulb. This shows the telogen hair. You can see that the lower end of the hair is just formed, reduced into a club shaped structure, and the remnant of the sheath at the dermal papilla is not there. So this is the telogen hair, and normally in all the individuals in the normal human scalp, around 25 to 100 hairs, they are in the telogen phase, and these are the hairs that are lost on a daily basis. So this shows you the hair cycle, and the first, this picture shows you that there is a well developed hair bulb and a dermal papilla. This is the active hair follicle in the anagen phase. And this shows you that this is becoming atrophic, the hair bulb is becoming smaller in size, and the dermal papilla is also becoming atrophic. This is the catagen phase, there is no active division here. And then this is the telogen phase, when the dermal papilla is just left behind and it is forming a club. And this is the telogen phase, and this is the exogen phase, where the anagen is reappearing with formation of the dermal papilla and the hair bulb activity. So what are the factors that control the hair cycle? The most important factors, although there are external factors like the seasonal variations also in the hair growth, the hair, they are supposed to grow faster in the summer season in comparison to the winter season, but hormones, definitely they control the hair cycle. And the most important ones are the thyroxine, it increases the hair growth. Estrogens, they decrease the hair growth. Rate of growth in humans is, as we know, that is 0.3 millimeter per 24 hours. And the scalp hair, they grow faster in females before puberty, and later it is the boys who take over. And highest growth rate is seen in around 50 to 69 years. It is very surprising, but then this is a fact. And androgens definitely, what they do is that they miniaturize the hair, they shorten the hair anagen, and they shorten the anagen and they make the hair go into the telogen phase. So now I shall be coming to the next part of
Dr.
the
Vibhu.
Yes.
Has then cutting, massaging, application of the oil will affect the hair? Can you throw some light on the massaging also?
Yes. The scientific studies, they show that these practices of massaging the hair with all kinds of oils will promote hair growth. So that has not been proven, or that has not been shown in the various studies also. So it is, the only effect is that since it produces the massage, leads to an improved temporary, you know, vasodilatation, improves the circulation, which is a temporary effect. So the effect is only, you know, it's that it is soothing to the individual. But as far as the promotion of hair growth is concerned, that is not there. So it is just a myth. And then again, there is a myth that plucking the hair will lead to an excessive growth of hair. So one should not go in for temporary methods of hair removal. So that is also a myth. So as I said, that the factors which control the hair growth, it is mainly the hormones that are there, and plus it is your genetic constitution that determines the length of the anagen in your scalp. So now coming to the sebaceous glands, can I have the slideshow? Now sebaceous glands, these are glandular structures which are again derived from the epidermis, and they lie in close proximity to the hair follicle in the dermis. And these glands, they produce sebum, and sebum is the natural conditioner of the skin and hair. It lends that sheen to the skin and hair that everybody wants. And together with the hair, this works as a functional unit, which we call as the pilosebaceous unit. Now, coming to the structure of these sebaceous glands, the glands, they are composed of lobes. It may be one lobe or it may be multiple lobes. That depends upon the size of the sebaceous glands. So large glands would have multiple lobes, and these glands, the lobes will have their individual ducts, and the duct is lined by keratinized squamous epithelium. Now the sebaceous duct is the chief duct of the sebaceous gland, and it opens into the pilar canal. Now each lobe of the sebaceous gland has different acini, groups of acini, which contain cells. And these cells may be in various stages of differentiation. The cells which lie at the base or towards the periphery of the gland, they are rapidly dividing cells, and the cells towards the lumen, they are more differentiated and they contain the secretions, the lipid secretions at the tip. The type of secretion of sebaceous gland is the holocrine. Now this figure would explain that the sebaceous gland is composed of series of lobes, and each lobe has its own duct that is lined with keratinized squamous epithelium, and the lobe has got different cluster of cells which are known as the acini, and the cells which are towards the lumen, they will have the secretions in the form of lipid, the sebum, which will be ultimately secreted into the sebaceous duct, and that will open into this adjacent hair follicle, the pilar canal, that is upwards towards the upper dermis. So this is another diagram to recapitulate that the sebaceous gland is lying in close proximity to the hair follicle and it is opening its duct into the pilot canal. So here we can appreciate it better that the sebum that is synthesized, it is thrown into the pilot canal and then finally it lubricates the stratum corneum on the epidermis. Now sebaceous glands generally they are present all over the skin, but they are absent. The areas where they are absent, they are the palms and soles. And we should remember that the largest size of sebaceous glands is there on the face, scalp and the upper trunk. And the number also is maximum over these areas. So this is important to remember because during the onset of puberty, menarche or pubarche, generally adolescents would develop an oily scalp, they would develop an oily face, and the upper part of the trunk, you know, that seborrhea, which we call excessive oil secretion, that greasy feel is because of that these areas of the skin, they have larger and numerous sebaceous glands. The number varies from less than 100 glands per centimeter square to around 900 glands. So that depends upon the area.
I would like to ask that what are the factors which influence the sebaceous secretion?
Okay. So sebaceous secretion, I would be coming to it that the sebum is the first glandular product in the human body. Sebum is there inside in utero also, and part of sebum contributes to vernix caseosa. Now the sebum is being secreted even at the time of birth, and that is again under the effect of maternal hormones. The hormones like estrogens and which are passed passively from the mother to the baby, they are responsible for the activation of these sebaceous glands in the babies, and you see in the form of, you know, neonatal acne and sebaceous gland hyperplasia. So that is basically under the effect of hormones. Then the sebaceous the rate of secretion goes down till puberty comes. So again at the time of puberty there is an increase in the secretion of the sebum, and that is under the effect of hormones again, like you have these androgens and this puberty, which leads to an activation of sebaceous glands. They hypertrophy, they become larger in size, and their secretion also becomes more. So coming to, I mentioned that we have sebaceous gland mostly in relation with the hair follicles, and they open into the pilot canal. But we must also remember that there are certain sites in the body where the sebaceous glands are present freely. They are not in relation with the hair follicles, and these sites are the margins of the upper lip, and these glands are known as pudicis spots. Then you have meibomian glands in the eye, Tyson's glands in the males, in the prepuce. Then you have these free sebaceous glands over the tongue and over the female genitalia. Now this shows you these tiny white specks, grouped, clustered, tiny white lesions over the lip. These are the free sebaceous glands or the pudicis spots. This is a normal finding, but sometimes people do get apprehensive about this and they take it to be some pathological condition and they seek treatment and they want these to be removed, whereas this is just a normal finding. Now sebaceous glands, they also develop almost at the same time as the hair follicle. The hair follicle was developing around 9 to 10 weeks, and since it is derived from the hair follicle, so it is just later by 1 or 2 weeks, and they become distinct at around 13 to 15 weeks of intrauterine life, and it arises as a downgrowth of the hair follicle. And the centrally positioned cells, they form the lumen of the sebaceous gland, and the cells that surround these centrally positioned cells, they form the duct of the sebaceous gland. Now coming back to the structure, As I said, that these glands can be unilobular or they can be multilobular. That depends upon the size of the glands, how active they are, how hypertrophic they are, and it may vary from a millimeter to very large, so much so that they may be obviously seen on the face, around the nose at the time of puberty. These glands, they may sometimes be seen, and in the scalp also. And there is another very interesting fact, that the hair that is associated with large glands, they are small, because we can understand this, that the face has very large sebaceous glands, but the face generally has villous hairs. So the hair size would be small in case the sebaceous gland is large. So coming to the function of these sebaceous glands, so sebaceous glands, they have a holocrine secretion, which means that the entire cell disintegrates to liberate the secretion into the duct, and the neutral lipids that are there in the sebum, they reach the surface, and the activity of these sebaceous glands is quite high even at the time of birth itself. So this figure explains the secretion, which is holocrine, and the cell is disintegrating into the lumen, the entire cell. So this is a holocrine secretion. And the rate of sebum secretion is determined by various factors. It depends on the age, first of all, that from 7 years to teens, it is very high. Then again, it remains high till about 20 years. It decreases, and it is higher in males and lesser in females. So sebum is the first glandular product in human beings, and the various other regulators of synthesis of sebum, they are the androgens, which are maternal in the neonates, the steroids, maternal. Part of secretion of sebum forms vernix caseosa, and these active sebaceous glands in the neonatal period, they involute. And ultrastructurally, these glands, they are endocrinally also very active. They have androgen receptors, and they have also receptors for MSH, and they express cytokines also on the surface. Coming to the composition, the surface film has sebum as well as epidermal lipids, and the sebum contains triglycerides, wax esters, choline, cholesterol, cholesterol esters, and squalene is unique to sebum. It is not found in any other race. The regulators, once again, diet. It has been seen that prolonged starvation leads to a decrease in the rate of sebum secretion. Hormones, testosterone increases the sebum secretion. And there are certain drugs like isotretinoin and ethinyl estradiol, the estrogen preparations, they decrease the sebum secretion. Now, coming to the functions of the sebum, lipid film, it controls moisture loss. It gives protection from bacterial and fungal infection. It gives barrier function. It gives barrier to the skin. And can we measure the sebum activity? It can be measured with the help of different devices, like we have lipometer and sebometer, sebutape, and even skin biopsy can be performed. So coming to the lipids of the epidermis. Now the epidermis, we have just compared it with the bricks and mortar model, where you can see that the keratinocytes, which are rich in proteins, they are embedded in a lipid-rich matrix. And this lipid-rich matrix, it forms a good surface barrier against the hydrophilic antigens. Importance of these stratum corneal lipids is that allergy to lipophilic antigens is more likely to occur at the lipid replete sites, and allergy to hydrophilic antigens is more likely to occur over the lipid depleted sites. So skin is a major organ of cholesterol synthesis, and 60 to 70% of the total lipid synthesis takes place in the epidermis, and the three key stratum corneum lipids are the cholesterol, ceramide, and the free fatty acids. And odolent bodies, which are also known as the lamellar granules, they synthesize the lipid in the stratum granulosum. And so this explains the sebaceous gland and the skin lipids.
Thank you, madam, for this enlightening lecture. Before coming to an end, I would like to brief our candidates of our detailed schedule in the month of January. There has been a slight change. On 7th January 2007, in the forenoon from 11 a.m. to 1:45 p.m., we would be holding lecture on medicine. From 2:30 to 5:15 p.m., orthopedics. On 14 January, in the forenoon, surgery. And in the afternoon, again from 2:30 to 5:15, we have lecture on obstetric and gynecology. On 20th, instead of the forenoon lecture, we would be just having the afternoon lecture from 2:30 p.m. to 5:15 p.m. on pediatrics. And the forenoon lecture of 20th has been shifted to 27 January from 2:30 to 5:15 p.m. on ophthalmology. On 28th Jan, we would be having in the forenoon ENT and in the afternoon radiology. It's very important for you all to attend this lecture as it will be on the practical examination in DNB and how to attempt these examinations. And with this, we come to end of this teleconference session. Thank you.